promises of the Word of God. The Lord is near to all who call upon Him. The Lord Jesus invites us with these words, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavily burdened, and I will give you rest." He said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. For I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even though he dies, yet shall live."
You may be seated. Believe it or not, you are here in the right place. Definitely the right place. Definitely the wrong time. Decades too soon. But we need to be here together. We all need to be here. Monica, Connor, Elizabeth, Kathleen, John and Maureen, Hazel and Ron, Mike and Andy, our children, military friends, to RCHA. When I look up to the sky, I'm not having a pod rain moment, just so you know. There are cameras up top. We're bridging the gap with the other chapel across the street there, across the lawn. We're also bridging the gap to Wainwright. So welcome, Wainwright. They are live streaming as they can. Wainwright, our hearts are with you. Welcome to the international community too, because the Bobbitts have many friends through the military community internationally. So we are many locations, but we are one service. So we are together in a variety of formats. And I think, knowing Niner, knowing Colonel Bobbitt, now knowing Dan, which I dare to say would never have dared to say before, now knowing Dan, Monica, he would be so proud because his people are being taken care of. And so, welcome. Take a deep breath. We're here. It's hard, but we're here because of a wonderful man that we love. And so, friends, brothers, sisters in arms, we gather to give thanks to God for the life of Daniel Bobbitt. We gather in God's presence to grieve our loss, to comfort one another in our sorrow, to gather to hear words of hope that can drive despair away and heal our hearts so that we can live anew or live with new hope and hope again. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, your ways are not our ways. We come with so many questions and anger, and deep, deep, deep sorrow. Be with us today as we mourn the death of Daniel. Give us the grace and assurance to know that we are never far from your love, which created us and which surrounds us in our suffering. May each here know comfort, hope, and healing. Amen. I invite you to stand for O'Hara, following the instructions.
Thank you.
What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the work God has sent, has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men, that they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and to do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it, and nothing taken from it. God does it so that men will revere him. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A ceremony that would bring our Afghan memorial vigil to people of the United States of America, and most particularly to the families and friends of the 43 American soldiers and airmen who died in action while under command of a Canadian task force in Kandahar. The coincidence of Dan's loss, and having to speak with the families and friends of those 43 American soldiers, set me back. And after I got over the shock, it led me to reflect on our people, on our profession, the missions past, the missions present, and on the place our families and our friends play in supporting who we are and what we do, and why our families support those who serve and do just that. As we bear the loss of a great soldier, a super gunner, an exceptional leader, a beloved family man, I would like to reflect briefly on why Dan, as a soldier and a gunner, served, what that service achieved, at what cost, and why our places within his service as friends, as battle buddies, and as family matters so profoundly. So why did we serve? Why did Dan serve? Well, in short, we that wear the uniform are a team of professionals with a Canadian flag on our shoulder, and our job is to prepare for and, when required, take the action to defend Canada and defend Canadians, and provide for the safety and security of our citizens here at home. Remember the spring of 1997, Dan was serving here at 2RCHA, was about to head off on a brigade exercise in Wainwright, or in Gagetown. That's east, not west, right? But instead of heading east, he and the regiment went west, to Winnipeg, to fight floods that were threatening hundreds of thousands of Canadian citizens there. With a smile on his face, he traded digging in Gagetown for slinging sandbags in Winnipeg with his troops, bringing huge relief to the citizens of that city and reintroducing to Canadians to the best of their Canadian forces in a period where we had lost some of the shine with Canadians. After countless weeks and weekends of preparing for the domestic mission, Dan went and delivered on the home game guarantee. And he provided for the safety and security of citizens here at home. And he helped put the shine back on our military with Canadians here at home. Promoting peace and security abroad, be it humanitarian operations, peace support, or combat operations, is our mission as well. A short 8 months after flood fighting, and right around the period of the ice storm of the century, Dan answered the call to serve the cause of peace and security overseas. I remember how he jumped to the call to deliver on the mission in the Balkans, twice. There, he and his troops established the military presence in the face of old combatants and the incredible assurance of stability to the people of that war-torn region that kept the dogs of war at bay and that allowed the people of Bosnia to climb out from under the travesty of that civil war. Dan, with his team and with his troops, delivered on peace and security abroad. And we all remember Dan's leadership and service in Afghanistan. There, he shared the risks and led his gunners to provide the umbrella of firepower under which Canadian, coalition, and Afghan security forces moved, fought, and operated. Confident that when the guns were needed, they would be there, protecting our troops and defeating an enemy. The result, lives saved. Troops confident in their teammates and their ability to do their job in the face of great danger, and increased capacity of Afghans to provide for their own safety and security. Dan and his troops and his service and their sacrifices then have led today to an Afghanistan that is able to secure itself, its own army, and its own police, and to an Afghan population of 34 million people who today are progressing in ways we and they could not have imagined, let alone believed possible, just a few years ago. Dan delivered in Afghanistan as well. Dan, the missions he served, the troops he led, and the partnerships he nurtured achieved everything he and they were sent to do, at home and away. He lived the Canadian Forces mission. And when Dan wasn't in operations, he was leading. He was creating conditions for and preparing his and our soldiers to be the best in what they do for what may come next. Last week in Wainwright, he was doing just that. Leading from the front, developing our next generation of gunners, warriors, and leaders, doing everything that we asked him to do and more. As our old chief of defense staff used to say, General Ridley was heard to say this more than once, we in uniform are volunteers, but our families are conscripted into our military life. Doing our mission, preparing for our mission, comes with real sacrifices at home. The Bobbitts bore their share of these, including long absences, missed sports practices, games, and recitals, missed holidays, birthdays, and anniversaries, and that much coveted family time. And now the Bobbitt family bears the ultimate sacrifice. A cost that you, Monica, and family are bearing with incredible grace. Let's look at who Dan was and what he meant to the words of his regiment and his regimental family. Dan's troops, gathered from across all ranks of the regiment, offered up loads of sentiments. And I'd like to share some of these with you now. From the junior NCOs, one writes, "While he may have been a bit overzealous sometimes, Lieutenant-Colonel Bobbitt was always excited to see how far he would go." From another, "He always took the time to say hello, no matter where you were or what you were doing. He genuinely cared. Hey there, Bobbitt," is what I would hear from a kind voice. Another states he genuinely cared about his troops and his family. "He was a soft-spoken but ferocious leader. His excitement and enthusiasm could not be matched and were contagious. His words and his energy reinstilled the enthusiasm and excitement in my life. He loved to recognize the hard work and achievement of others." From some senior NCOs, "He remained true to himself and changed little as he advanced through the ranks. He was dedicated to the mission and maintaining a hard stance on the mission, caring for his troops before himself. He always went out of his way to recognize his troops, no matter their rank or how busy he was. He always had a smile on his face, and he took the time to talk about whatever was on your mind. And he always was good for a 3 a.m. surprise visit to the gun position to see how training was being conducted, pass on points of encouragement. Niner was a hard charger. He showed me it was okay to push the troops to their mats as long as I was there to lead them. No matter where I was or the time of day or night, CO would be there. Once in the middle of the night, at West Lookout Water Position, I stuck my head in the CP, and there he was. He kind of caught me off guard. I said, "Do you ever sleep?" He smiled, chuckled. That was his reply. Junior officer shared some of these sentiments. "He was a gentleman in the truest sense of the word, with a sharp intellect, an aggressive spirit, and a deepest commitment to his subordinates and to their opinions. He was a tenacious leader who inspired the pursuit of excellence and a legacy of courageous leadership. And he embodied and lived each day a as a true example of what an officer should be. From his badge of commanders, the CO was an inspirational leader. He was a role model and mentor, balancing military commitments with family life, the kind of leader I want to be. He was a warrior who led by example, was unwavering in his commitment and genuine in his compassion for his troops. He inspired our regiment. And from his second in command, Jen Codson, Jen wrote these words: "Lieutenant Colonel Bobbitt is like a Labrador retriever. Genuinely happy to see anyone and everyone. Boundless energy. Loyal. Protective of his pack. At work and at home. Intelligent and compassionate. Unassuming and living in the moment. Not focused on how the current situation sets him up for tomorrow. His command wasn't about where it would get him, but about where it would take his regiment. And that is the mark of a great leader." And lastly, a sentiment from his regimental family of the Royal Regiment of Canadian Artillery: "We know that Dan knew, lived, loved, and believed in family, his friends, his second regiment, his Royal Regiment, and in you, Monica, you, Connor, you, Elizabeth, and you, Catherine. He lives in and lives on in you and in all of us. We chose Lieutenant Colonel Daniel Bobbitt to command our 2nd Regiment. For all of these reasons and more, he was chosen for all the right reasons. Dan commanded his regiment and died while doing just that. In service to his troops and to his country, we are eternally indebted to him. Monica, you, Connor, Elizabeth, and Catherine have always been and will remain a part of our regimental family, just as we will remain a part of yours. We are here for you, and I guarantee that we will remain so. You are ours to care for, and Dan, our brother, will remain ours to honor and to remember, and we will always."
I served for a number of years with him.
It's certainly my honor today to say a few words. He was my colleague, he was my commander, my mentor, my confidant, my role model, my buddy, my BFF. But like me, for so many of you, Dan was so many things. And I think we all know that. When I was asked to speak on behalf of colleagues and friends, I was deeply honored. But I honestly, I struggled to find words, and I know that may be shocking to those of you who know me. But the impact of Dan on my life, I think, can be shared with all of us. Because I think my story with Dan is so similar to everybody else. So what I'll try to do is I'll try to just explain a little of my life with Dan and the Dan experience. And I think, if nothing else, I think you'll recognize Dan in it, even if you don't recognize much of it. His impact is so easy to see here today, and I guess for the internet, perhaps, or the other church. I know there have been events in my life where I thought to stop and drop everything, wasn't always able to, but clearly today that has happened for so many people. And that speaks to him. There's folks from coast to coast here. There's folks from, lots of folks from Nova Scotia, of course. And there's people from outside the country. And for those that really could not make it but wanted to be here, there's been all kinds of posts on Facebook, and it's been amazing. And again, that's no big surprise. There's lots of stories with Colonel Bobbitt, with Dan. And so I can't speak to all of them. Luckily, I was there for a percentage of them. Right in the middle of it, I'd say. But instead, what I'll do is I'll try to just explain a few of those and of my story. And I think you'll get something out of it. I would say that by doing that, by telling those stories about Dan, we continue his legacy. And that, for me, is terribly important. We've all told Dan stories, and we continue to do so, but now it'll have just that more, much more significance. There's so many. There's hundreds, right? From his solo assault river crossing after a night of mess across the Petawawa River, to his various injuries after nights of the mess, again, crud, Iron Man, a slip on the streets of Toronto before the Grey Cup, and generally running into things. It's sometimes hard to balance what was an amazing professional Army officer and this other guy that a lot of us knew. But what's left with me, professionally, obviously, is all the stories, amazing stories, of his leadership in Afghanistan, which, of course, I got to see firsthand. Dan always led the charge with his family, and he certainly led it in the Army. And of course, we all know that if there was any fun to be had, he would be leading that charge as well. He was at the center of it all. My story, though, with Dan actually starts before I was even born. That's hard to believe, I know, but my parents served with Dan's parents in Germany. And as was the case with a lot of people in Germany in those days who wanted to travel on the weekends and take advantage of being overseas, John and Maureen asked my parents to take care of baby Dan so they could do just that. And I wasn't even born, but already he was having such a positive impact on my family. Such as the power of Dan. My mom, Brenda, recounts that baby Dan was a delight to take care of. He was such an easy baby. My father, Ray, loved having another baby around. I would like to say particularly a boy. Augmenting the experience of having my older sister, Leah, who preceded Dan by about a year. I would arrive a few years later, and I think in reflection, Dan had such a positive impact that It's entirely possible that Dan may have very well played an important role in the genesis of my early existence. Such is the impact of Dan. I didn't really get to know Dan the man, though, until I arrived at RCD in the mid-1990s. I was a somewhat experienced lieutenant, newly arrived component transfer from the reserves. And though I run into him actually with 30 Steel augmenting that tourist HA, the Derek and Dan romance hadn't yet quite begun. But I do remember very clearly Dan and a few other fellows who are sitting here today being at the center of ensuring that I had a very memorable and appropriate welcome to tourist HA. I'm not going to share all the details with you today, but just let's say there was a mix of poignant teasing. Followed by some hearty laughs and a genuine welcome to the regiment. And it's a truce. Through countless exercises, lots of time in the mess in those years, going to Dan's home, I got to know Dan and the family, and through a series of epic events, started to really appreciate who this person was. There was lots of laughter, and lots of mentorship. And even before Dan became instructor in gunnery, he already understood clearly what it meant to help to mentor and develop people. And so even though he was only a few years ahead of me, I'll just share a brief anecdote with you that highlights the professional impact. Just before he actually took off to Gagetown for his IT course, Dan, just for a little while, was the acting BK of the battery. We were in a high tempo, as usual, for the regiment. High tempo time. And Dan, as the acting BK, had the administrative answers that I needed in garrison to get that admin done for the troops, because we were yet again deploying for another field exercise. But he wouldn't give it to me. And at the time, I thought he was a bit of a jerk for doing that, frankly. Little did I know that he was trying to teach me another lesson, which luckily, before he left for Gagetown, I realized. And it's simple. It's something maybe some of you don't hear, but he made me look at the references. He made me do the work so that I wouldn't have to rely on anyone else, that I could understand what was required in that leadership role, and that I could complete the administration myself. Something simple, but something that stuck with me for many years. When I found Dan, and luckily I did just before he left, I told him, I said, thank you for doing that. And there was no I told you so, there was none of that, and of course it was typical Dan fashion. It was a slap on the shoulder, a bit of a laugh, and an acknowledgement that, yeah, in fact, that's what he was doing. And of course, we spent several minutes talking about professional things and personal things, even though he was in a rush to clear out and move on to each other, the bigger and better things. He always made the time, and in the short couple years that I was learning, he had a direct impact on that. And even with all of his inexperience still at that stage of his career, Dan quickly became someone who I wanted to be. Flash forward a few years later, and I was an IG student myself, and I felt very fortunate to have guys like Wade Caddy and Sean O'Leary and some other great instructors there. I saw those guys as some of the best gunners and some of the best that the Royal Regiment had to offer in terms of instructors, so I felt very fortunate. Admittedly, though, today, most of all, I have to say I was looking forward to having Dan. He was also one of my key instructors. That relationship and that friendship had already struck, and my appreciation of his professional abilities, I was so looking forward to learning more from Dan, and he did disappoint. That year we grew closer in my profound respect for him as a person and as a professional or even woman. When Dan's hands finally were needed elsewhere, those skilled hands, as he liked to say, he went off to Canada Command. And that didn't last long, because clearly he was needed up in Petawawa to lead deep action. So, Task Force 107, deep action.
I remember the day that Dan phoned me and he said, Krabby, do you want to, as he referred to me, Krabby, do you want to be my, do you want to be my QIC guy? I could really use your help. And obviously I had to go home and talk to Jennifer about that, but my immediate reaction was, of course, I wanted to be there for him and support him in that endeavor. And when I remember the first sit down between myself and Dan, and at that time being a 7th Wagner chaplain, and right away I knew that those soldiers were being taken care of because the three of us together had something very special. D Battery was in excellent hands with Dan at the helm, and with Chad and I in supporting roles. And over those pre-deployment mission months, we bonded, and what happened to us, of course, overseas deepened that bond. We saw it eye to eye professionally, but beyond that, I think I can say that we became close friends. We shared many challenges and dangers together, some from the back of his boat, and others at a distance. Of course, those two shared even more adventures together. But I can say that I'm proud of the three of us, and I'm proud of the support that we certainly gave him. But I just want to make sure one thing is absolutely crystal clear, that Battery Commander Dan led the charge. And the mission success was his. Even though Dan didn't always look the part with those horrible safety glasses that he had initially, because his prescription glasses were late, you know, typical Dan. Even though he didn't always look the part, he was the real deal. I saw him in action, and in the middle of chaos, that is sometimes battle, bombs dropping and battle groups maneuvering, words like precision, decisiveness, expertise always came to mind. It was my privilege to watch him in action. After Afghanistan, I moved out to become a regimental OXO, and Dan and Chad stuck around for a little bit longer until Chad was posted out, and eventually Dan was selected for staff college. But somehow, yeah, we both ended up on a French course together, and that was a tremendous 4 months. There was lots of laughter, there was lots of learning. We really enjoyed being able to order a hamburger and french fries at the end of that. Somehow we made it through and we got our levels that we needed, both of us. We also may have spent a little bit of time in the principal's office for some of the tomfoolery that went on in class. But it was classic Dan. He was adding value to fellow students, teachers, while still achieving his military mission. When Dan finally left for staff college, down to the States, we continued to correspond. And of course, down in the States, Dan immediately got close to all kinds of new folks, including a bunch of international folks. And this is no surprise. But the Dan and Derek story carried on, and eventually, after a couple we got to see each other again. And with Dan, you could just pick up where you left off. And there's not a lot of people in life you can do that with. So that just speaks to the quality and the type of person. Then Dan worked hard in his favorite job ever, CPRO, in Ottawa. He commanded that cubicle with pride, I believe. Of course, got a chance to spend some time together again in his house in Russell and I believe at the AB in Charlotte, which consisted of another epic night in Brandon. He then made it down for some PD in Gagetown, and yet again, we just picked up where we left off. And that says something special about Dan. When Dan was informed that he was going to be the CO of RCD, he was over the moon. It was the place where he grew up, it was the unit where he'd gone to war with, and now he was going to command it. And I just have to say, when Dan referred to the 2nd Regiment, by the way, he wasn't referring to Petawawa, or certainly not the Zeppelins, not the guns, he was referring to the people. The people are the regiment. And he couldn't have been prouder of those those people who he had served with and who the people were mourning. That for Dan was the second mission. So when he said he was proud to serve in the 2nd Regiment, he was referring to the NCOs, the officers, everyone, and that was he. He came back as the CO for some more PD in Gagetown, and when I asked him how he was going, we joked a little bit that his new Chad, our son Garth Hoagie, and his new Derek, which was Jen, of course, things were going very well, and he was enjoying them so much. I was a little jealous, but of course, that's just Dan. He's got lots of friends everywhere. He loved the BCs, the BSMs, the officers, the NCOs, the RSM of the regiment. To our CHA, no CO loved you more. Bear with me, I'm just about through here, but I'd like to go back to DBAC to Afghanistan, just for one more little story about them. So the DBAC to the Dragons, as we like to call ourselves after the Taliban, described us that way. Task Force 107 provided many highs and lows. It was an amazing challenge and reward. It was personally difficult, but we stuck together and we got through it. I could relay many close scrapes that Dan and I had, and many more that Chad and Dan had. But instead, I want to say something else that speaks to Dan's number one priority, which is his family and friends. He did the business over there, and he did extremely well. In fact, you can always count on Dan. But beyond his intense love of the Army and the people who make it up, his greatest love is family and friends. So just one quick, obscure Afghan story to share with you. Once we got there into the springtime, of course, things got very busy overseas. So busy that even the brigade FSCC officer, it was all hands to the pumps. Wade was passed out to go work with the soft guys who were being supported by one of our gun troops. So regardless of where you were or what you were doing, everybody was busy. I and another TAC-P forward air controller were gaining frequent fire points in helicopters, planning with headquarters one day and then deploying out as facts the next. The Canadian can-do attitude was persistent. It was an incredible tempo. At one point, another slightly dodgy task popped up, and potentially it was going to be me, an Eastern European nation who was having some issues with collateral damage with their FAGs, was going to be working close to the Canadian AO. So potentially, gravity was going to be thrown into this. I already participated in a few dodgy type of missions, but this one looked potentially very challenging. The way that Dan and I usually operated was once we got a mission or an op order, we would take some time to sit down and discuss it in my role as 2IC. The potential that we looked at followed our usual path, our usual battle rhythm. We took a look at the op order, discussed how we would technically and tactically support it. We talked about equipment and risk, the keys to success. But then there was a pause, and typically, next we talk about the criteria for mission success, but this time, there was an awkward pause, and I waited. And in the middle of all that military necessity, and what had been weeks of ticks and challenges, instead of us carrying on with our usual battle rhythm, Dan put his hands to the side of his head, and he said, "If anything happened to you, Jennifer would never forget." And the both of us laughed a little, and shed a bit of a tear, because that was a poignant moment for us. Amongst all the chaos, it spoke to who Dan is, and he clearly had one foot in Afghanistan, but he had another one at home, when I clearly had forgotten all about that. And I'm not saying that I didn't think my family, thought of them every day. And certainly, we always weighed the mission against the risks to our soldiers. But very clearly, he was the type of guy that never, ever had family and friends off the line. And again, I don't want to say that Dan was at all risk averse, because he certainly set me out a number of times. But from Dan's perspective, families and wives and children were always part of the equation for him. This to me was amazing. And that moment for me sums up Lieutenant-Colonel Dan Bobbitt as a professional and as a person. Always committed to the mission, but never ever wavering to his commitment to his soldiers or their families. Dan was the real deal as a commander. And many talk about their commitment to soldiers and family, but I have literally just seen it spill right out of them from him. I don't think you can separate the Army officer from the father. You can't separate the gunner from the son, the brother, the husband. Dan loved the artillery. He loved the Army. He loved his soldiers, and it was such a huge part of his life. I know that because I saw him in action. And throughout our time in the regiment in the 90s, or at the artillery school, preparing for deployment, on deployment, on French course, PD, you name it. Always and everywhere, there was one constant theme with Dan Bobbitt, and that was family and friends. I know, because every conversation with Dan from the 90s up until very recently always went there. For me, above all else, this is his legacy. His love for his friends and family. And friends and family, you were never far from his thoughts, and I know because I saw them. To our CHA, your CO loved you. Garth and Jen, he was proud to serve with you and thought the world of you both. Friends, wherever you might be, Dan loved you because he always thought and talked about you. And Chad, of course, you know how he felt about you. He loved you. John Marie, Dan loved you, and he always had a great story that usually revolved something around you, John. But he always lovingly interviewed you. Mike, Dan loved you and was so proud of you, in uniform, out of uniform, the Army website, you know, all the stuff that you did, incredible. You were always part of the conversation. Catherine and Elizabeth, girls, your dad loved you so much. I know because he told me, and I know because it was easy to see how much he adored you. Connor, your dad loved you and is so proud of you. You are your father's son, and that's a good thing. It says a lot about Dan, but it also says a lot about you. Monica, Monalicious. Dan loved you, and I know because he told me. I know because of how many stories and anecdotes, and how often his thoughts turned to you. You were the center of his universe, along with the kids. I know that because he told me. And because his every action demonstrated that. Dan, my mentor, my colleague, my commander, my friend, for me, like so many others, you were many things. But I think I can surmise by saying simply that I love you, brother. Not sure I ever told you that directly, but I know you know. So for me, Dan, I'm not saying goodbye, no way, because you'll always be with me. And I'll miss what could have been my friend, but I will never miss what was. And I'll never forget. I just want to say two last things to you, Dan. You can stand easy now, we'll take a look from here. And finally, Dan, you always looked a good quote. So I'll leave you with one. And you also know I'm not very original, so I looked at this from a movie. And the character in the movie was quoting Abraham Lincoln, who said part of what's known as the horizon prayer. He said, "Life is eternal, and love is immortal, and death is only a horizon, and a horizon is nothing but the limit of our sight." Dan, my boy, I will see you when I reach that next horizon.
As this was early May, the runoff had made the river quite frigid, quite fast moving. So we steeled ourselves and plunged into the water. The intent was in a big hurrah and out, which is what we did, because it was very, very cold. So there may have been some not so manly howls coming from the water, but the mission was achieved. Safely back on shore in the deep dive, we were ready to head back home. We'd been in the water for, I'm gonna say maybe about 20 seconds total. Next, two things happened almost simultaneously. First, Dan patted his pockets. Where there were van keys, there were no more. And just as Monica started to say, "Are you freaking kidding me?" The skies opened up. So we stood there for a moment, in the pouring rain, staring at a locked van. And then Dan, living on that familiar knife edge between sitcom and divorce. We did eventually find the keys, but it took probably about 15 minutes of wading through this freezing cold water. Just moments ago, it was too cold to get in for more than 20 seconds. So it was a good time for all of us. By the time we did find the keys and got into the van, everyone, three kids from each family and both wives, was just as soaked as us who had been wading around in the river. So a very popular move, I believe. Dan's personality can only be described as larger than life. From his test pattern shirts to that goofy grin that preceded the mission, he always had, or always was, a source of entertainment and comradeship. And somehow, regardless of how crazy his antics were, he always had a partner in crime, and usually several. I don't know if this speaks more to his innate leadership abilities, his constant generosity, or the gullibility of his peers. Dan's life teaches us not to take anything for granted. He savored every moment. He never let an opportunity pass. He grabbed hold of life and took it for a ride instead of waiting to see where it wanted to take him. Yet, he never belabored it. It was never forced or tried. You always knew a visit with Dan was going to be a good time. Laughter and good times followed Dan like the weight of personal lightness in his trip. Monica, you're the sister I never had. We shared a good many times together. We laughed, cried, and we've grown together. To the casual observer, you'd think we had spent our entire lives together. I know I have on occasion wound you up a little. You can always be able to give as good as you get, and usually a little better. You are forced to be reckoned with, and most of your mortals would back down from that. You are the only one who can ever claim to have tamed Dan, although you hardly disagree. Regardless, we can all say that the trials you have endured have likely made you eligible for sainthood, so you may want to check with the proper guy. Catherine, your dad has always held a special place for you. And like or not, you will always be his baby girl. He took special pride in the moments you shared together, and I know he cherished that bond. Even now, I can clearly see the smile that came when he talked about you. Elizabeth, you are the spitting image of your father. Your manners, your personality, your easygoing friendliness and openness to everyone around you. Thankfully, though, that's hairline. Having heard all that has been said about your dad in these past few days, you know that these traits will keep you in good stead as you continue through life. And I know you'll continue to be the amazing person you are. If I hug you out of the blue sometimes, because you remind me so much of you. Connor, you're about to embark on a life-changing adventure, and it will be amazing, my friend. Know that you have proud people right behind you as you make your way through this journey, but also know that you're your own man. Your father was loved by many and achieved a great deal, but it took him 43 years. As you start out, don't hold yourself to that same standard. Remember, I knew your dad when he was your age. You've got a good head start. To all three of you, I'm so glad you got to know your father. He loved you all so deeply. You were always his first priority. He was blessed to have you and you him. To my parents, I thank you both for the steady guidance and positive examples that you provided. You created the environment that fostered all of the positive attributes we have seen in Dan today. Not only did your efforts turn out a world-class guy, but you had Dan. Provided the love and support we have received. Family and friends have gone to great lengths to be here with us. Dan's colleagues have appeared from the far corners of the world and shared stories and memories when travel was not possible. Soldiers of the regiment have been simply amazing. They've helped us navigate this unknown ground. They've lent us their strength, and they've shown us the kindness simply unknown to civilian families. I don't think we could have made it through this difficult time without all the kindness, love, and support we receive from you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "I tell you the truth. I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. But I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. For this command I received from my Father. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Please be seated.
We have heard lots of stories today, and there have been many common themes. And as I was sitting there, I was going, shoot, I wonder if I should edit. But the stories are all common because it's all about dance. And of course they're common because we all picked up on the same stuff as we got to know them. So the stories are going to continue now, but with a little bit of a different start. So, I'm not crazy, but the date, April, the year 1863. See, I got your attention, right? You're all going, oh yes, Padre, we're going to go to sleep now. And now you're wondering, why the heck 1863 April? Yeah, I know, you're going, what's happening, but you're paying attention. April 1863, a woman is walking, the location, Columbus, Mississippi. Now, for those of you who are history buffs, you know that it is not the end of the American Civil War. It's 3 years before the end of the American Civil War. And a woman is walking among the graves, adding flowers to very well-tended graves. And then she walks to the corner to a couple of mounds of dirt and puts flowers there. "What are you doing?" she's interrupted. "Those aren't our soldiers. They're from the north." And softly she answers, "I know, but I also know that up there, there's a mother, or a wife, or a sister, or a brother, who is mourning them just like we grieve ours." This is a simple story, but it is reportedly the start of Memorial Day down in the United States. This weekend, my inbox was full of Memorial Day messages. I'm sure yours was too. And forever in my mind, Colonel Bobbitt's death will be associated with Memorial Day. Now, unlike in the South, where there, some of us, where there, people are gathering and intentionally looking for places to honor their soldiers, we don't have to look for a place or a reason. Our place is here, and our reason is here. What we need to look for is a why. Because it doesn't make sense. And I don't know how many times I have heard that as I have walked among to RCJ, why it doesn't make sense. Monica, It doesn't make sense. Military friends, it doesn't make sense. And to RCHA, it doesn't make sense. Meyer's death does not make sense. But we have the choice to give it sense, to take senselessness, and to not get stuck in our anger, because there is lots of anger. We can pretend it's not there, but it is, because he's a good man. So we can get stuck in our anger. We can get stuck in our exhausted souls, because we are tired. Or we can find a way to give meaning. Now, just like in that little story, words of wisdom often come from wives and mothers. Now, if this was a Baptist church, I'd expect an amen out of that. And it's not, but wives and mothers. And Monica has had words of wisdom this week. And Monica, I don't even know if you recall, but as I've sat with you around the sofa, around the table, at one point you said this. There are two gifts in the death of Dan. And these two gifts are: one, that his death was quick and instant and painless. And the other, that he died doing what he loved. Now, if there are gifts in his death, then it's up to us to find the gifts for us in living. Because there are, because that's what gives reason to what doesn't make sense. Most of us, or many of us, if you can't have it, if you don't have this picture, perhaps you can create it after all that we have already heard about Lieutenant-Colonel Dan Bobbitt. Most of us have a picture in our head from 2RCHA of Colonel Bobbitt with his head out of the cloud, with his helmet on, with the scrim flying in the wind, cam painted up, those funky brown goggles on, and the grin. And Monica, I'm sorry, but it is a goofy grin. And he would grin, and we know he was grinning because he was doing what he loved and because he wasn't in the office. And he had a whole group of clerks doing what he needed to do in the office. But he loved it, and we would see that picture. There's no dignity with scream on your head, but he would stand there with his finger there, and that grin was a part of it. If there can be gifts in a tragedy of death, then it's up to us to find the gifts in life as well. So here are some of the thoughts that I have from that and from Colonel Bobbitt living boldly, scrim flying in the wind, okay? So being here at Dan's funeral, at our CEO's funeral, reminds us that life is short and that life is a gift. It reminds us that we are not in control. It reminds us to use the time we have well. It's a reminder to figure out what we love and to do it boldly, to do it with funky brown goggles and candles and a goofy grin if you have to. And for 2RCHA, it's a reminder to do it boldly but wisely. Okay. My transcript actually says within the law. I know I don't mean to say within the law, I'll just say wisely to the chapel next door. Right. I still get the emails. Yes. It's a reminder to do this together. We all need a fire team partner. No matter where we are, even if it's a cubicle. and neither would have been lost without Monica, without the RSM, without the chief clerk, and a whole bunch of clerks. I don't know, RSM, how many berets you had in tow, but I know you had some. Headdress was always an issue. There is a story about his very first parade, but it's not to be said in public, about the kit that was missing. Even I, a padre, noticed the missing kit. A fire team partner. We do it together. And this is the last one, and it's the toughest one of all. We have to figure this out with everything in it. We've got to do it boldly, right? That's come across in all that's been said today. We do it boldly. But at the same time, we have to hold it lightly, because no matter how hard we try, we're not in control. Those accidents happen. So we have to figure out what we believe about the control thing. Whether it's spirituality or religion, a belief system, family, whatever it is, you need it too. Because that is what balances that sense of senselessness of training accidents. So either we keep going expecting an accident to happen every time we take a lab out, or we figure out how to live life bigger than that. For me, that bigness is my faith. For you, I don't know. But today challenges us to think about it, because accidents will continue to happen anyway. And I'm here to tell you that I know beyond knowing beyond knowing, because I've lived it to the nth degree myself, that no matter what, somehow, there is hope. But we have to find it. It's a part of our responsibility to do what we do well. Life must have more meaning than accidents. And I have seen it in action this past week in so many ways. We find them together, boldly, with brown goggles. We find it together because that is what gives us the strength to soldier on. Sometimes limping, sometimes crying, sometimes staggering, sometimes running, sometimes with goofy grins. We give today meaning by doing all of these things, remembering Dan's death and the life he has had, and the life that we live as we soldier on, and we shall soldier on. The pastoral prayer is written in your bulletins. You're welcome to follow along or to listen as I pray. God of grace and glory, we thank you for Jen, who is important to each of those gathered here, and now who has passed from this life. We thank you for the friendship that he gave, and for the strength and peace he brought. We thank you for the love he offered and received while he was here with us. We pray that nothing good in the life of this man will be lost, but will be a benefit to the world, that all that was important to him will be respected by those who follow, and that everything he valued will continue to mean much to us now that he has died, inspiring courage in his
informing conscience. Merciful and compassionate God, heal our hurting hearts, strengthen us in our weakness, calm our troubled souls. We acknowledge our doubts and fears, meet us in our anger, give meaning to what seems meaningless. Teach us to trust, help us to hope, give us strength to live and live well, with the courage to laugh, tell stories, cry, and be better people because we dare to love. Please stand.
Heavenly Father, we commit ourselves, body and soul, to your keeping. When our life is in danger, give us the courage to deny our duty. When we are tempted to sin, give us the strength to resist. When our task is difficult and the goal seems unclear, grant us the endurance to persevere. If we are sick or wounded, grant us healing. If we should fall, in your great mercy, receive us. Bless all those who are near and dear to us, and grant us wisdom and understanding in all our family affairs. Lord God, help us to remember with thanksgiving the courage and fellowship of those who have died for the cause of righteousness and peace, and those who have shared with us in the life of our regimental family. May our service to the 2nd Regiment, Royal Canadian Horse Artillery, and hence to Canada, be diligent and honorable in your sight. O God, amen.
Reflective music of Fare Thee Well and for the reception.